Take a T-Rex. Give it wings, a flaming breath attack, add impenetrable armor, up its bite force by an order of magnitude, magnify its already keen senses even further, and you have the perfect predator. Right? Nope. You just created a movie monster. Not an animal that's actually going to thrive as part of a sustainable ecosystem. Here's a more useful qualitative metric, relative perfection, which is the sum of an organism's ability to A. reproduce, especially more than once, B. forage consistently without significant injury, and C. resist external environmental change. Those three factors together summarize a creature's success. Not how big it is, not how strong it is, not what it could beat in a fight, besides the minimum required to survive. But Vividen, you may be thinking, how could you of all people be saying that T-Rex isn't perfect? Isn't it the biggest, strongest, baddest land carnivore to ever exist? What about megalodon, the 100-ton whale killer? Or Deinosuchus, the monster alligatorid that ate dinosaurs? Aren't they all contenders for the perfect predator? Well, it's no secret that T-Rex is my favorite animal. Anybody who's been watching the channel for more than 30 seconds can figure that out. What I'm saying is that the Awesomebro idea of what makes a good predator, aka physical combat prowess, is only a small part of the picture. Since this is mainly a paleontology channel, let's take a look at a hypothetical scenario I cooked up a while ago with the megatheropods in the Cenozoic video series. Here, a group of large theropod dinosaurs were transported to the Cenozoic and needed to adapt to survive in each period. The biggest obstacles to their survival weren't the giant tusked herbivores like mammoths. Quite the opposite, in fact. The theropods struggled the most when there weren't populations of big animals that could defend themselves, because they were not adapted to take on small game. Carnivores? An incredible animal. Beautiful. Terrifying. It's not going to be happy in a forest full of cat-sized horses, since it was selected to take on elephant-sized sauropods. Being overpowered for a scenario is not the same thing as being perfect for that scenario. Being a successful predator is all about how to be part of a balanced ecological system, not what can pointlessly kill the most prey or look most charismatic on a safari. Spotted hyenas are more efficient than lions in terms of their group hunt success rate, up to 74% compared to 30%, but even that doesn't make them objectively a superior animal. Something that's phenomenally adapted for its niche can be total crap in other environments. In an extreme example, throw megalodon into a forest, or a megatheropod into the open ocean. Spoiler alert, they won't do well. The idea of a predator that really can fill every apex niche is simply fantastical. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that natural history's greatest hits weren't impressive. The dinosaurs were the dominant large vertebrates on land for well over 100 million years, and would still be today if it weren't for an orbital bombardment. Genetic drift is random selection, entirely independent of fitness. And let's be honest, if an asteroid on par with the Chicxulub impact hit Earth right now, humanity would be screwed. Does this mean that small mammals were better animals than dinosaurs because they survived? Not really, no. They just had completely different requirements to reach relative perfection. From an evolutionary perspective, setting a low bar for your energy requirements is not a bad thing. You might not be big and flashy, but you'll still be alive. Specialization is the way to dominate a niche, but generalization is how to cheat mass extinction. And I'm not saying that all animals are created equal in everything. That's clearly not true. A crocodile is going to be better than an eagle at ambushing large mammals on the shoreline, and an eagle is probably going to be better at flying. T-Rex was the best at taking down massive, agile, and armored prey animals, and carnivores or large allosaurids like Saurophaganax were the best at hunting sauropods. So while the idea of the definitive ultimate predator is a myth, there can be multiple perfect predators scattered throughout Earth's history. As long as they meet the conditions of relative perfection, which again were successful reproduction, being able to eat, and weathering change, they get an A+ from Mother Nature, which really is all that matters. Also, I'd like to give a shout out to Reddit user EG0, who described my channel as Awesomebro content done right. That actually made my day. I know I complained about Awesomebro attitudes earlier in this video, but I do think there's too much of a push in the opposite extreme within the paleo community of not letting other people think that animals are cool. I mean, nature is metal. It's silly to pretend otherwise, and I'd like to encourage everyone out there to allow yourself to appreciate the crazy cool things in the world. It's okay to like an animal because it's big and scary. Exploratory science is all about channeling our inner child, not suppressing it. Thanks for watching. This video was kind of a random project I put together, but I had fun thinking about it and sharing those thoughts, as jumbled as they may have been. If you like paleontology or animals in general, I'd love for you to subscribe and join the community. I'm a paleontology master's student and fantasy writer, so if you're interested in either of those nerdy things, feel free to join the Discord as well. I'm the Vividen, and I'll see you next time.